Hello, good morning, and welcome to the TikTok Transparency Forum. I'm Francis Stones, and I'm the Brand Safety Lead for Europe and Israel at TikTok. For those of you joining us for the first time, the goal of this event is to create a forum for discussion on the issues important to you. TikTok is home to a diverse set of creators, communities, and trends, all driving entertaining content and building connections. Fostering an environment where this creative expression thrives requires that we prioritize safety, especially for our younger community members. And that's our focus today, how TikTok is working to protect our younger community, which is those over 13 years old. So for the next 45 minutes, you're going to hear from youth charities, teachers, creators, advertisers, and TikTok experts who will discuss the challenges that face the industry, and how TikTok is responding to create a safe, inclusive, and responsible experience for teenagers who use the platform. We asked you to submit questions during the registration process, and we will address as many as we can today. We also have subject matter experts on hand, so if you do have a minor safety question you'd like to ask, please post it in the chat box and we will answer it during the event. Right, let's begin. I'm delighted to introduce you to today's moderator, James Chandler. James is the Chief Marketing Officer of IAB UK, the industry body for digital advertising.
Thanks, Francis. I'm really looking forward to chatting with some leaders in the field of minor safety. Kicking off today's session, we have Dr. Liam Hackett, CEO of Ditch the Label. Ditch the Label support people aged 12 to 25 through some of the biggest challenges in their lives, from bullying and mental health to identity and relationships. We also have Lynn Sutton, who is Head of Outreach Partnerships at TikTok. Warm welcome to you both.
Hello.
Liam, tell me a bit about Ditch the Label.
Well, Ditch the Label is a global non-profit, and we're here to help young people navigate the biggest issues in their lives. And I think the thing that really makes Ditch the Label different is we're really passionate about speaking to young people constantly and hearing from them what their biggest challenges are and how we can add value. You know, we give real practical advice and support in ways that doesn't patronize, it doesn't alienate, and genuinely empowers young people to make better, more informed choices. And I would say our biggest thing is empowerment of young people.
So there's not much finger wagging going on. This is how you should be doing things.
Yeah.
And Lynn, what do you do at TikTok?
So I lead the outreach and partnerships team for EMEA. We work as the gateway between our trust and safety teams and external partners. It's very important for us to think about making sure that we have a wide range of experts that are feeding into our policies. Mm-hmm. We don't want to ever develop anything in silos or just within our own ecosystem. We want to sense check it. We want to work with really great partners like Ditch the Label to make sure that what we're building is fit for purpose and that in the real world it will help those users that we're intending to support.
And tell me how you guys are working together right now.
Well, I mean, at Ditch the Label, we're really passionate about working with industry, working with partners who really kind of share our vision for empowering young people. And so, you know, it's no secret, social media is a massive part of all of our lives. Mm. There's so much incredible stuff when it comes to social media, but there's also some challenges. And we are, you know, it's in our manifesto to work with partners like TikTok to really kind of support young people in using social media in ways that enhances their lives in really healthy, responsible ways. And so we've been really focused on dangerous challenges. We've created some incredible curriculum, which is now being run in classrooms across the country. And this curriculum is all about equipping young people with critical thinking skills when it comes to seeing dangerous challenges. You know, we're not going in there saying, don't do it. We're not telling them what to think or what to believe. We're actually teaching them about the psychology, the biology of risk-taking, and even things, you know, like how hormones can influence risk-taking in teenagers, etc. So that when they do see these dangerous challenges online, they're far more informed, and then they're able to make their own choices based on the education that Digital Label and TikTok has given to them.
And it probably goes further than just social media. I mean, these sort of lessons for life in a way.
Literally, lessons for life.
It's not just dangerous challenges that you work on. I mean, there's all sorts of things that you're doing, Lynn. And lots is made of the technology, you know, with in our industry with these types of companies. But people are at the heart of safety as well. Tell me a little bit about that and particularly the pace at which you've been hiring people as well.
So I've been with TikTok for just over 2 years. In that time, we've seen an incredible increase in the amount of people that are working with us. We have grown globally at a really fast pace, but it's been an intentional pace as well. We think about making sure that the people that work with TikTok reflect the wide variety of communities on TikTok. We have experts people who work coming from various backgrounds, really diverse backgrounds in terms of safety, policy, advocacy, regulation, making sure as well that they are bringing those skills into us. And we do have people with tech backgrounds that helps. We are a second generation platform that's allowed us to maybe look at the ways that social media and tech platforms or online spaces have grown, how people interact with these spaces, how people consume content. With that hindsight, we've been able to think about how we want to develop our platform, the kind of people that are right for us to maybe think about recruiting. And we've been looking because we have an amazing team.
Yeah, there's so much in our industry, isn't there, about being first with things, media first, global first, but actually being second generation, as you say, has all those benefits as well. How does the incredible pace in terms of safety and hiring, how does that keep up with the pace of the product and how much that's developing? Because that's going at kind of lightning speed as well, isn't it?
Yeah, we've definitely moved very quickly. There's a huge amount of features and products that we release. We want to keep iterating the experience on TikTok and making sure that it's new and fresh and fun. But we do that with a safety by design process. We think about making sure that everything that we build goes through a pretty robust internal process, but then really importantly goes through external validation as well.
Right.
Working with our safety advisory councils, working with our NGO partners, academia, research, these are really key elements to help us understand not just what we believe is right, but making sure, sense-checking, validating, working with those external partners, helping to make sure that if there are blind spots that we may have missed, that those are identified, so that the products that we release are fun and fit for purpose.
Yeah, so you get sight of stuff even before, you know, people do.
I just think the culture at TikTok is incredible. Mm. And, you know, I think being second generation actually works in your favour, because from my experience as an external, I mean, I could be wrong, but I get the impression that TikTok is super innovative and has some of the brightest minds around trust and safety. And so is really pioneering the solutions to many of these kind of challenges that is across the board when it comes to social media. And it's actually really exciting. And, you know, for us as an NGO, we've been kind of banging this drum for a decade at social platforms. And it's really refreshing that you guys really see the value that partners like Digital Label provide and, you know, the kind of experience that we bring to your product and, you know, kind of making it a safe space. And so we really value that relationship and that kind of symbiotic nature of it. It's actually, it's incredible.
In terms of the school report card, how are they doing? Cover your ears, Lynn. How are they doing?
I would say pretty well.
Okay.
I mean, it's funny because, you know, everybody that we knew in trust and safety, all of a sudden, you know, kind of 3 years ago, now worked at TikTok. And it's actually been really incredible to witness that. I've never seen anything like that happen before. And I would say a solid 9.5. My life philosophy is nobody's ever a 10 because I think things are always changing. You know, new problems are kind of emerging. And I think to be a 10 is to be complacent. And I don't get the impression that TikTok is at all complacent. And we need to continuously evolve because these behaviours, these attitudes, you know, the very nature of technology and society as a whole is always changing and evolving. And so we should always aspire to be a 10, but we never quite get there. It's kind of my philosophy.
Not 9.5 is pretty good. You must be happy with that.
I will take that.
But is there a restlessness as well? Like, you guys know that you're not going to be a 10. It's never going to be this complete thing, right?
Yeah, it's absolutely everything that Liam says. I completely echo. The ecosystem online keeps changing, and we need to make sure life outside, I mean, outside of platforms is changing, and we need to make sure that we are updating, that we have policies and procedures that are supportive of the users. Like, we speak about the fact that kids today have very different challenges than they did, or, you know, teens today have very different challenges than they did previously. Yeah. We have an opportunity to, particularly when if TikTok happens to be their first platform that they are joining, that we can help them to understand how to navigate online, how to be a good netizen of the world, how to have a fun and safe experience. And that's done in partnership with great organisations like Ditch the Label.
There's lots of sophistication that goes on behind the scenes with safety, but tell me about the sort of the table stakes, the hygiene things, you know, me coming to a platform and telling you that I'm of a certain age. I mean how those are kind of basic things that we've got to get right.
Yeah, we care really deeply about creating a TikTok that is for users aged 13 and up. Mm-hmm. So when teens are coming online, we want to make sure that the first thing that they are presented with is a screen that you put in your date of birth. Mm-hmm. You put in that date of birth. If it's lower than the age of 13, we'll just send you a notification saying, thanks for checking us out, but you're not ready right now. We also then consistently monitor the platform to make sure that if we are seeing users that are potentially under the age of 13, that those accounts are then removed from the platform. Yeah. We want to work with partners externally so that we're helping teachers, parents, teens themselves to understand why it's important to have their real age on the platform. For us, we take a very graduated age approach within safety. So that means that users that are up to the age of 16, so between the ages of 13 and 15, will have slightly different features than those a little bit older.
Right.
So things like they don't have access to direct messages, mm-hmm. Accounts are defaulted to private, and then other things in terms of account recommendation, we would default those to off.
And what about some of the more complex, sophisticated stuff that goes on behind the scenes? I mean, we talked about the number of people and the amount of people who've been growing, but there's some great technology in the back end as well that's working.
Yeah, we think about using a blended approach of humans and technology. Neither by themselves are perfect, but both together give a pretty robust system. So technology, machine learning helps us to build for scale, and then human moderation makes sure that we have accuracy and that we're thinking about content that should be on the platform and removing anything that shouldn't be there.
Yeah. How open are TikTok to feedback, to critique, you know, some of the more difficult stuff that you have to give them?
I would say out of all the social platforms we have a relationship with, definitely one of the most open. And I think that's really important because, look, if you take the evolution of the internet, it started off as a tool for science, then it turned into commerce, and now it's evolved into this incredible tool to connect us all together. But the point being, it was never designed with that purpose in mind. And so now, as a society, we're like, oh my God, like, this is great, but also there's so many challenges that come with this technology. What do we do about it? And we're still trying to figure it out. You know, in the UK, we've got the Online Safety Bill, which is now kind of going through. Yeah. And legislation is now starting to catch up, almost kind of a little bit too late. But the point is, we're all a stakeholder in this technology. It's a big part of all of our lives. So, you know, whether you're an NGO, whether you're a social platform, an advertiser, a parent, whoever you are, we all have a collective responsibility. And I don't think anybody has all of the answers yet. And I don't think we ever will get to that point because it's evolving so quickly. Yeah. And so in order to succeed in this, I think it's essential for social platforms to be so open-minded and so open to criticism and to working with external partners to validate, as you said. And it really shows. And I think that's really fundamental to TikTok's success and how they really are pioneering user safety.
Yeah. And we've talked about charities and NGOs and other forms of validation. Where are advertisers on this? Are they pushing you quite hard?
Yeah, advertisers care deeply about safety on platforms. Particularly now, we want to make sure that we are creating a space where people feel very confident to spend their advertising dollars, because there's multiple options. There's various places that they can go. We hopefully create a system that is fun. It's a great place to be. You can reach the audiences that you want, but safe in the knowledge that we think about users' safety, that we think about people's safety really deeply, that the safety by design is infused in everything that we do. And if we have happy, safe users, we should have happy, safe advertisers.
Got it.
They can definitely push us harder. It's good to hear that people think that we can take that feedback, but without that feedback, there's no platform. So it's really important that we keep hearing from external parties and those that have interest in our platform so that we can continue to improve and that we can continue to evolve as online spaces evolve.
Yeah. Thoughts for people that are watching this then, Liam? I mean, you've got this sort of fascinating helicopter view of what everyone's doing here, but what excites you about the future, about where this platform, where the industry might go?
I think, fundamentally, the internet and the technological advancements that we're having is just so fascinating to watch. Mm. You know, kind of, I still vaguely remember maybe 5 minutes when the internet didn't exist, but I'm kind of like the last generation that remembers that. And it's so fascinating seeing how it changes our human behavior, it changes our relationships, it changes even how we feel about ourselves. Yeah. And to be in that space of kind of trying to counteract some of those harms, in a way is really, it's kind of terrifying because you're seeing some of the darkest parts. You know, we're dealing with some real challenging things, but it's also really exciting because, you know, Digital Label's reaching millions of young people every year. And so we have this real opportunity working with partners like TikTok to not only counteract some of those online harms, but give them transferable skills so that, you know, they sit through a free lesson module on online challenges, but actually they're leaving that classroom more empowered with life skills to critically evaluate the world, whether it's online or offline. And to be in that position, I think, is so incredible. And it's just so exciting because things are always changing. There's always something new.
Yeah.
And to be kind of constantly responding to that is actually, it's not for everybody, but I love it.
Yeah. And Lynn, final thought from you.
I think it goes back to us, feedback. And I say that obviously sitting here as on outreach and partnerships, but I am one person representing a huge trust and safety team that are deeply committed to us getting this right. So the more that we can hear, the more that I can share back with the team, the more that we have a chance to shape the platform that is for everyone.
Lynn, Liam, thank you so much. What a great chat. And there's more to come, so stick around for our next panel. Now we head into our second panel of the day, where we're going to dive deeper into the needs of younger users. I'm joined by Vicky Schotbolt, CEO and founder of Parent Zone. Parent Zone's mission is simple: to improve outcomes for children in an increasingly digital world. Mr. MBA, TikTok creator and teacher, and Jade Nestor, head of data public policy for Europe at TikTok. A very warm welcome to you all. Vicky, let's start with you. Tell me about Parent Zone. How did it come about?
It's quite old. It's older than TikTok. 2004. It came about because we wanted to support parents moving into a world that was becoming increasingly digital. Mm. The internet was going mobile. When we started, you were all far too young to remember this, but when we started, there were still flip phones.
Right, yeah.
David Beckham was advertising them.
Yeah.
And the internet was not something that you consumed on your smartphone, but we were right at the start of that era. Mm. And that's why we started Parent Zone, because we knew that was going to bring a whole load of complexity and opportunity for parents and for young people. And we wanted to be there, I guess, to hold their hand was the thinking.
And do you find yourself now talking more about the complexity or more about the opportunity?
It depends. Mm. Right now, this very minute, we're talking a lot about complexity, a lot about the negative stuff, and that's because of a bill going through Parliament, the Online Safety Bill. It's not where we like to be honest, because for us it's always about getting that balance, the balance of opportunity, and that's really important, because if all that parents hear is the scary stuff, the natural instinct is to say, let's not go there, let's keep kids away from it, and that's not good, because we want children consuming, enjoying, learning, growing, all of that good stuff that digital can support. But our job is to make sure that they can navigate the risk effectively and that the place is safe enough for them. And that it's kind of finding that balance that we try to do all of the time.
Christian, Mr. MBA, don't know which you prefer, school teacher and TikTok creator. If we looked you up on LinkedIn, would you be a creator or would you be a school teacher?
A bit of both,
actually. Both can coexist. Yeah, yeah. When did that all start? When did you start creating TikToks?
Back in 2009. So I started making revision videos for students studying for their GCSEs. Yeah. And came across TikTok and just saw it as a platform. I thought it was like any other platform, but was just shocked at how viral it, and the reach that it had. And so I just started producing different types of videos to educate, entertain, motivate on TikTok.
What do your pupils say about it?
They love it.
Do they love it?
I talk about it quite a lot, so if some of them think it's a bit cringe, but I don't mind.
Have any of them featured? Any sort of guest spots?
Yeah. I've had a couple of students feature in it. And what I want them to see is the ability that they have agency themselves. They can make their own, they can pick up a phone, they can create content, they can be a media producer. So when I teach GCSE media or A-level media, I'm teaching the students how to be able to be media producers.
Got it. Data public policy. Yes. What does that entail?
quite a few things. basically, things that keep people safe online at the high level. So privacy, security, well-being, also child safety writ large, accountable design, various different things. Yeah.
Where are parents on all of this, Vicky? I mean, what do they think, feel about TikTok? Do they at all?
Some do. And I think, you know, I look back to when Parents Own started and it was rare, really, for parents to know very much about this stuff at all. We now have generations of parents coming through who love it as much as we do. I mean, there are loads of TikTok influencers who are parents, for example. Mm. So it's changing, and different parents with different age children will be at a different stage in their journey. But typically, I think it's still true to say that parents feel a wee bit overwhelmed and they're still really concerned, because it is not easy to know where to set the boundaries, to stay up to speed with every single platform, and kind of stay in touch with your child's digital life is a big ask of parents.
Yeah. Do you find that as well?
Yeah, 100%. I think that when you're working with young people, there is kind of a balance between recognising that they're still young people, but they're becoming adults and they're going to want to exercise their agency and be more mature. And I guess as a parent, as a teacher, you're trying to give them principles to be able to apply in different circumstances. And that's no different for being online. You want them to be safe online and to be appropriate online and to know what's safe and what's not safe. And I think that while you want to give them the principles so they can kind of regulate their own kind of use of the media, they also need the support of the media platforms to provide them that kind of safety mechanism.
Got it. And Jade, you're nodding vigorously. So the idea that we're not finger-wagging and telling young people what to do.
Yeah, so we have what I would call some harder controls, like family pairing, where parents can restrict their teens' use of things like direct messaging or what kind of content that they look at, their screen time. But then you mentioned principles, and a lot of what we've been trying to do recently is education for parents, but also for teachers, to make sure that they understand TikTok, how to use those harder controls. But then we're also doing work to facilitate the conversation in the first place. Because even when parents think that they understand how social media works, they don't necessarily understand the lived experience of the younger users, and their teens might be a bit resistant to some of those conversations. So we're trying to give them the tools to approach them for that conversation, and also, to your point, recognize that their teenager has rights and is evolving and has a right to freedom of expression, and that can include TikTok, that can include other platforms. So that's just something we're having to educate them about as well.
This is an interesting thing on sort of digital media literacy. I think I would say I'm pretty good, but if you ask me specific questions, is that a broad case? Do people say, yeah, I feel pretty literate in these things, I can do these various things, but maybe not as good as what people think?
Unfortunately, people do exactly what you describe. We all score ourselves quite high on media literacy. The truth is, actually, people's levels of media literacy are not that high. And that's because it's a very complicated skill set to get. And some of the old ways that we used to have about teaching media literacy, which you'll know better than me by far, but the kind of pre-digital media literacy skill set is a completely different skill set to the one that we need now. And we're still updating how we help people navigate this huge avalanche of content. Mm.
I worked on a campaign with TikTok and MediaSmart to help put together a kind of way of helping young people know when they're being sold to. Because with the rise of influencer marketing, sometimes you get content that's being produced that's marketing to people without being like disclosing that it's actually an advert.
Yeah.
And so putting together some of those tools was to support that, because actually we do believe we're quite media literate, but actually for this younger generation and for just your average person, actually there are some nuances that are coming with this new platform and new media.
Yeah.
And those videos were great. You know, if you watch them, you realize it really strikes the balance between a TikTok tone that the teens enjoy, that all of our users on the platform actually enjoy, and educational. You know, so it doesn't come like it's some sort of someone reading from a book. You know, it's very relatable, and I think it's hugely important for us to keep doing that, keep reaching people in a way that resonates with them.
How do we get that balance right? Because it's an important one between creativity and safety, because the pendulum can kind of swing either way, and probably not one extreme is better than the other.
Well, we know that for people to be creative, they need to feel safe. Mm. So we've been trying to embed safety by design into the platform, and that applies for everyone on the platform. But in particular, if we're thinking about age-appropriate design, we're thinking about different features, different controls for users who are 13 through 15 to provide guardrails for them based on their age and their developmental level. And the same thing with people who are between 16 and 17. Because we know that their experience is going to be a little bit different, that they're putting their feet into the water a little bit more and want to do things like some of the interactive features. But we limit some of the interactive features, for example, from the younger users, because even though that can help express creativity, they might not be ready for that level of interaction. Mm. So this is just something we're constantly thinking about. And thinking about it, I would say, independently of just regulation, thinking about it in terms of best practices and trying to embody through conversations with young people what works for them, what works for their parents, what works for their teachers.
Yeah. I think about when I was learning about stuff outside of the classroom, doing GCSEs, and that BBC Bite Size was a huge thing for me, you know, sort of carefully curated content. There was only one version of it. Yeah, you're talking about how you've maybe done revision things. The way you might talk about it in another credit might be completely different on how we do Pythagoras' theorem or whatever it might be. What's your view in terms of, is there room for both, or are we now in a world where we have to accept that everyone can kind of create content?
I definitely think there's room for both, but I think we're moving rapidly towards users or people using the internet or social media wanting an authentic experience. And so people would rather kind of put away the kind of the really polished and really finished, you know, article and have something that somebody's done in their front room.
Yeah.
They'd rather have that because they feel they can relate. And that's what it's all about, really. It's about relating to other people, which is why you get all sorts of people becoming really successful on TikTok, because they're relatable.
Yeah.
And I think the more that content is relatable to the user, to the person who's using the end product, they're the ones that are going to really connect with that person that's behind the screen.
Yeah. Is there a trade-off with relatability and authenticity, though?
A huge trade-off, because what you're letting go of is that editorial checks and balances, making sure that the quality is there and that everything's accurate, and that's all really, really, really important stuff. So fantastic if a young person navigates their way to a TikTok that's been made by you because you're a teacher and you know what you're doing, but there's nothing to stop that same young person navigating towards content of a much lower quality. So that is the trade-off, and I don't think you want to lose either. You want the authenticity.
Yeah.
You want the person that the young person can connect with and go, actually, I'm inspired to learn something about maths, and normally I hate maths. Mm. But you also need that really good teaching and credible resources.
And we've introduced content classification as is something that we're doing internally. So it will be more like a movie rating system, so people can figure out what content is appropriate to make that experience a little bit better. Hopefully, though, they land on a lot of teaching videos. Apparently, there are 32 billion views on, I think, teachers, hashtag teachers on TikTok.
A lot of them
are probably yours.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're always hoping that, the good content gets out there, but we're trying to make sure that it's age appropriate.
And I feel like we know so much more now than perhaps certainly I did when I was growing up about different ways of learning. And you know, it was always very binary. I'm a visual learner or I learn by listening to people. But now we just seem to know so much more about how we learn about things differently. To summarise then, we've talked a fair bit about the challenges, opportunities, Vicky, as you see it, with the sort of the internet in general.
Oh, I'm a massive internet optimist. I think it's the most democratising, that's not an easy word to say, democratising thing that anybody's ever invented, and that opportunity to be part of a global community, to talk to people that share an interest with you, maybe in the other side of the world, is just extraordinary. And we have to embrace that, and we can't let all the safety concerns of really legitimate, but we can't let all of those get in the way of that big opportunity.
Nice. Yeah, I definitely agree. That idea of equity, you know, in the past, old media has kind of had a stronger hold on how we get our content, but now there is a sense that anyone can be a media producer and anyone's voice can be heard. Mm. I think there is some work around whose voice and how those voices are kind of propelled, but I definitely think there's a real equity that TikTok provides users to be able to kind of hear different ideas and different thoughts and shape your worldview.
Yeah.
And I think for me, our opportunity is to think creatively ourselves about how to keep getting it right and how to interact with people on the platform, particularly young people, teenagers, to figure out what is the experience like for you? What can we learn from you? Because every time we talk to younger users, they tell us something useful, amazing. We've made product changes based on things teens have suggested in groups. I'm sure that they would love to know which ones they specifically suggested. But that happens a lot, and I'm excited to think what we can learn from them in the future.
Great. Thank you, Jade, Christian, Vicky. Thank you very much.
Another amazing conversation, but we've got more to come, so stay with us. We've had some great discussions so far, but it's not over yet. In our final panel of the day, I'm joined by Katie Eiten, Chief Compliance Officer at Omnicom UK, and Giles Derrington, Senior Government Relations Manager at TikTok. Welcome to you both. So, Katie, you've got the ear of your clients on this. What's important to advertisers?
Well, I think first and foremost, they want confidence that the platform they're advertising on is safe for all users, but particularly for younger users. They want to ensure that their brands are reaching an age-appropriate audience, that they're being able to target the right age and in an appropriate and safe way. Mm-hmm. They want to know that a platform is compliant with privacy and data protection rules, as you would expect. Really, it's just about making sure that it is a safe environment and that they're reaching the right people.
There's nothing in there that's going to surprise you, Giles. I mean, it feels like table stakes, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And look, you know, we think about this a lot from the position of, you know, what do advertisers want, but also what do our users want when we're dealing with kind of teenagers on the platform, what do their parents think as well as obviously what governments want, and actually trying to bring those together. And often it's exactly as you say, it's those kind of important things about, can we be assured that, you know, the right things are going to happen, that we're able to target the right people, and that we can feel confident, and ultimately that users can have a great time on the platform, engage positively, and then kind of go away happier than when they first logged on.
So you've got to be 13 or over to use the platform. How do you make sure that happens?
So I guess there's three things that we do which are really important. All three kind of have to work in tandem. Mm. So the first is educating people on kind of what the platform is and kind of what the rules are. So we are a new platform kind of relatively. So actually explaining to people that it is a platform only for over 13s. We've actually got quite a big publicity campaign going on at the moment saying, TikTok is for over 13s. That's first and foremost, kind of get people up to understand how we work. The second is, when we have people logging onto the platform for the first time, We're asking them for their date of birth, but importantly, we're not asking them you must be over 13 in order to log on. Yeah. It's a neutral age gate, so enter your date of birth, and if you're putting in a date of birth which is younger than 13, you know, then we'll be blocking you from accessing the platform. Yeah. And then finally, and probably most importantly, as people experience the platform, you know, we're constantly looking for signals, identifiers, which might suggest that someone is under the age of 13, therefore shouldn't be on the platform. And we'll be using, you know, human moderators to kind of look at those things. We make it really easy for other users to flag someone they think might be underage and kind of be really proactive about that. So again, we can feel confident. And we're quite transparent about these numbers as well, which is, you know, we're one of the few platforms that are. So, you know, so we talked about, for example, in the second quarter of this year, we removed globally over 20 million people from the platform for being underage.
Couldn't you save yourself a big headache, give total assurance to advertisers and just say it's going to be an 18-plus app?
I mean, look, some people...
Slightly provocative question. I think I know the answer.
Fundamentally, you know, we think the app should be there for people who are appropriately aged to use it. Yeah. And we think about this stuff as building blocks. So, you know, if you are 16, you're not getting access to the whole app straight away. We think about this in terms of age-appropriate design. So, for example, if you're between 13 and 16... you won't have access at all to our private messaging system. If you're over 16 to 18, you'll have access, but it'll be turned off by default. We're trying to bring people the tools as we feel that they're appropriate for their age category. Yeah. I think ultimately, if you just set kind of an arbitrary 18 threshold, there are a lot of teenagers who really enjoy the app, want to experience it, and will try and find ways to experience it. So we want to make it worthwhile for them and work for them in a safe way, rather than trying to kind of arbitrarily cut them off there.
Yeah. It's a good answer from Giles, which I'm glad of. But the broad strokes thing doesn't really work here. It doesn't really work in anything, whether you look at privacy or you look at safety. All of these things have got nuance, haven't they?
I think so. I mean, wouldn't it be great if you could keep everybody in a lovely little childhood Victorian bubble and only release them into the world when they were 18? But I don't think it works that way. And I don't think it would be fair to teenagers to say, right, there's huge swathes of the internet that you can't access. It's about how you make that access safe for those younger users. But it is a trade-off and it's difficult. And I think, you know, sometimes as an internet, perhaps there isn't as much debate as there could be about some of the different options, not just what you could do, but what the pros and cons of that are. So whether you go down, for example, the route, as some platforms are looking at, of something like biometric facial recognition, for example, as a way of identifying age, but then you're processing quite privacy-intrusive data there. So you've got to balance that up against the accuracy and how well it's working. If you go down a route of, say, requiring a government ID, verification, passport, driving licence, again, which is something that's been suggested in a lot of quarters, you know, that solves some problems, but it introduces others, particularly for the substantial minority of people within this country who don't have a passport, who are too young to have a driving license. We don't want, I don't think, to create a society of kind of digital haves and have-nots, where there's whole swathes of people who are unable to access the tools, the technologies, the content that their peers can get. And I think that is a risk of going down that route. You know, there are lots of different things that we could do. They've all got positive and negative implications. So I think that's where there needs to be more of a debate about what are the pros and cons and, you know, the different options that are available to us.
Yeah.
And I think that's right. And I think, you know, certainly there are no silver bullets. And one of the things we've been really conscious of at TikTok is listening to parents of teenagers and to teenagers themselves about what they want, what they'd be comfortable with. And actually, when it comes to, as you say, the, you know, giving your passport details, not just to TikTok, but to, you know, 20, 30 apps on your phone, people get, you know, understandably, they don't want to do that. And so actually, you're looking for different solutions from that. I think it's very easy to say, oh, if everyone just kind of took this data in, everything would be fine. But actually, if that's not what teenagers want, if that's not what their parents want, then it's not going to work and then people are going to find ways around
it. And there seems to be quite a lot of evidence in some of the recent Ofcom reports, for example, that actually where you do have instances of you know, younger children sort of accessing social media platforms generally, that actually in a lot of cases, it's actually their parents and guardians who are helping them to set up those profiles and get online. So it does feel like it's a tricky balance to get right there.
And that's why going back to the, you know, that very first step of educating everyone on what TikTok is, the fact that it's an over 13 platform is a hugely important part of that, because you can only start in a way which is kind of working with what people understand.
Yeah, it was exactly the point from the panel before with Vicky, where she's talking about literacy, you know, literacy on these platforms amongst adults. Lots of people saying I'm very literate in them, but actually when you look at it, perhaps they're not. I'm reminded as well of sort of intentions and maybe unintended consequences. If you think about something like the cookie privacy notice, a consent, so I need to get consent from you to use your data, but the way we've gone about it is every time I want to go on a site or use some content or do anything, I've got to, and I'm actually not reading the notice, I'm just saying yes. So it's actually the total opposite to the thing it was intended to do. So you kind of have to be careful how you navigate these things, right?
And look, you know, even governments have struggled with some of these things, right? So these are complicated issues. And again, that's why our starting place on this is listening to parents, listening to teenagers, listening to advertisers, and trying to bring that together and figure out, OK, what are sensible solutions, what are practical things we can do?
Maybe something with... perhaps there's something else that's more definite, and that's around harmful content. Talk to us about TikTok policies on that, how it's stopped, how it's taken down.
So, again, our community guidelines are set at quite a high threshold for some of these content. So, for example, even things like misogyny, which most platforms don't automatically have rules against, we've chosen to make that something which is not allowable on our platform. And that allows our content moderators to moderate against it. So where they see it, they can remove it. And that allows us to have the kind of confidence about what people are going to see on the platform. And again, I think for us, a lot of this comes down to we want TikTok to be a fun space, an entertaining space, rather than somewhere where, you know, they're going to see, you know, the latest kind of terrible thing. We want people to come off the platform feeling happier rather than kind of like the world is terrible. Mm.
How do you manage that, though, from sort of the algorithmic side of that, though, as well? Because I think it's not just about individual pieces of content necessarily. A lot of the challenges that I think you see are around what happens when an algorithm detects a user's engagement with a particular topic and then naturally wants to serve more and more and more content about a similar or related topic. And I think, you know, in the vast majority of cases, that works really well, and you see more content about the things that make you happy. Yeah. You see the kitten videos, you see the nice stuff. But there is a small minority for whom, you know, the content that they're perhaps engaging with is not as positive, you know, whether that is eating disorders, whether it's self-harm, all of those sorts of things. How do you manage that and identify it and know when to say stop and enough is enough from a content perspective and get them back into that happier place?
Yeah, so again, I think there's three things which, you know, we need to do. So the first is, you know, working with experts, because often, as you said, a lot of this stuff is quite nuanced. So take something like eating disorders. Recovery videos are incredibly important for some people who've been through that, seeing other people who've been through the same thing, how they've got out of it, and kind of having that community is incredibly powerful for some people's recovery. For some people, that's incredibly triggering. And it's not as easy as saying, well, you can stop that or you start that. So working with those kind of charity experts, whether it's Beat on eating disorder content or Samaritans on self-harm content, to actually understand kind of, OK, what should the rules of the road be, first and foremost? Then secondly, it's about that kind of content moderation, policing, kind of having very hard lines of what we know we won't accept, kind of removing that from the platform quickly, efficiently. And then thirdly, you know, where we do see people looking at kind of the same bits of content over and over again, something we're working on kind of a fair bit at the moment is how do you begin to diversify that content. So if you see someone seeing, look at just healthy calorie options, in and of themselves, that might be a really good thing because someone's trying to lose weight. But actually, if someone is looking at them over and over again, actually might be a sign of something else. So how do you go in and, you know, through the algorithm, diversify them away, kind of give them a broader sense of the videos? I think the one thing that TikTok has in its favour on this is because we are a short video platform, people are seeing lots of videos. It has, actually, that dispersion becomes easier because no one is just watching, you know, 15 cat videos in a row or 20 cat videos in a row. You know, people get bored of content quite quickly. So we can use those tools to diversify the platform in a way which is enjoyable, but also helps us get to a more safe place as well.
And maybe it gets back to the point you made earlier. This isn't, I think there's a view that there's algorithms and technologies sort of working independent of any human thought. Of course, there's a big human process in this thing as well.
Absolutely. And, you know, all of this stuff has to start from a position of what do we think is the right thing to be doing and then how do we build the tools to it? And again, that's why we start from a place of what is age appropriate, what is content appropriate, what are, you know, what are teenagers telling us that they want to see, what are parents telling us they want to see, and working through those. I think one of the challenges you find, kind of, if you just take a kind of hands-off or wait for a kind of regulation approach to this, is that regulation differs between different countries, and actually it has to be kind of a value of the platform that we want to be like this. We want to be an entertainment platform. We don't want that kind of content on us.
Well, let's go from regulators to government then, maybe. I mean, the last year or so has been interesting, certainly in the UK, but across Europe and probably ever in the world. Permacrisis, I think, is the term that coins it best. How more difficult has that made your job engaging with policymakers, government officials?
Well, I think, you know, anyone who kind of works with governments day to day has not had a huge amount of sleep over the last 6 months or so. It is calming down at the moment, which is positive. Mm. I think actually, though, on the kind of the big things affecting our industry, there has in some ways been some stability. Mm. So you think of something like the Online Safety Bill, the kind of flagship regulation in the UK. That bill has been going through Parliament, or kind of being developed since before TikTok existed. It started actually a couple of months before TikTok launched in the UK. So we've been following that bill very, very closely for a very, very long time. I think actually on those bigger issues, we want to work with government to go, well, what do you want? Kind of how will this work with our technologies? What are the things where actually we can tell you about what the future looks like so that you're future-proofing your legislation effectively as well, rather than just kind of waiting for it to impact us.
Yeah. We've talked lots about the challenges, rightly. But to end on a positive, what are you hopeful about?
For me, I think the big thing that I see as a real positive is the extent to which everybody's now engaging with these topics, and I think really open to having a proper, meaningful discussion that goes beyond just some of the surface issues. And the fact that we're actually sitting here talking about it now, I think is illustrative of that.
Yeah.
You know, I think we are moving away from that, all right, let's just quick find a simple solution that's going to fix everything.
Yeah.
But actually, you know, advertisers, agencies, we want to understand and get into more of the detail of these things. How does this work? What are the decisions? What are the trade-offs that need to be made? And how can we work with and engage with platforms to make this a better space? Because I don't think it's something that anybody can do in isolation. Mm. And that, for me, that desire to engage in this space, to have proper, meaningful discussions about it, is kind of one of the most positive things that I'm excited about for the future.
Yeah, and we've heard throughout all of today that ears are open at TikTok, you're listening, you know, you want that external critique, you want that view, and much the same here.
Yeah, look, I think a lot of this stuff is about partnerships because a lot of it is new and, you know, as we said before, there are no silver bullets.
Yeah.
So we need to hear from advertisers about what they think. We need to hear from parents. We need to hear from, you know, users of all ages to kind of get this right, as well as hearing and kind of engaging with government. I think if we can have that collective conversations in forum like this, then that's a really positive thing.
Yeah, Giles, Katie, it's fascinating. Thanks so much. And that's it for all the discussions. It's back over to Francis.
Thank you, James, and thank you to all of our speakers today for sharing their expertise with us. We hope you found the session valuable, and most importantly, that it's given you an insight into the continuous work that happens at TikTok to make our app a safe place for our community. We spoke about how product and policies are created in partnership with industry experts. We discussed the importance of education and finding that balance between creativity and safety. And then finally, we heard the perspectives of the advertising industry. It's important to continue the conversations we started today, and we'll do that in future transparency forums. We know that by working together, we can overcome many of the challenges that face our industry. If you want to speak to us about any of the topics we covered today, please do reach out directly or share your feedback via the QR code that will pop up on your screen shortly. We'll hold our next transparency forum in early 2023, but for now, thank you and goodbye.
Hey, welcome to London. My name is Stuart Flint and I look after GBS for Europe and Israel. We're going to give you the lowdown on all of the work that we've been doing to keep TikTok safe. Follow me. Making sure that everyone feels safe to express themselves on our platform is our number one priority. Here's Ellen to tell you about all that we're doing to keep our younger users safe.
It's my job here to think about the things that will make TikTok a safe space for under-18s to explore. My team has helped build industry-leading youth safety measures, restricting access to TikTok lives and direct messaging for younger users. We've also introduced privacy and feature settings, including parental controls and age assurance technologies.
Say hi to Caroline. She knows everything about moderation.
We use humans and technology to review everything. That's videos, comments, sound, text, emojis, and profiles. Our community guidelines and policies are designed to prioritize diversity, inclusion, authenticity, but above all, safety.
Creating a safe environment for our community also means that it creates a safe environment for our brands. Let's go to Delphine to find out more.
My team has been working hard to build brand safety and suitability tools that reflect our vision for the future. We heard from global advertisers. They wanted scaled brand safety verification across all objectives in as many markets as possible and be able to customize. We created our own solution, the TikTok Inventory Filter, our most flexible option for advertisers. It uses machine learning to give advertisers more control over where their ads run. This is an evolution from third-party solutions such as IS, OpenSlate, Zephyr, and more.
Awesome. You've heard a lot about safety on TikTok, but there's one more area I'd like to show you. Every bit of progress that we make gets us closer to making TikTok the most trusted platform on the planet. It's our biggest mission. It's our North Star. Thanks for visiting the home of TikTok safety. Feel free to pop back at any time.